Dr. Mittal is Director, Preventive and Clinical Cardiology from Medanta Hospital. Dr. Sanjay, please.
Good afternoon to you all. Today I am going to talk about the type 4 PAH, and I am going to focus on the specifics which I know of this type of pulmonary arterial hypertension, which is thromboembolic pulmonary arterial hypertension. So it is a disease which is not so much frequent as the cardiovascular disease related pulmonary arterial hypertension. The incidence would be of, because it is most commonly related to thromboembolic pulmonary embolism, we expect that 66 to 104 patients per 100,000 population would be having pulmonary embolism. And out of them, 3 to 5 per 100,000 would have chronic thromboembolic pulmonary arterial hypertension, which would mean that almost 0.1 to 10% of people who have had pulmonary embolism would turn out to have chronic thromboembolic pulmonary embolism, pulmonary hypertension, which is around on an average of 4%. And this is something which has been there for every country in this particular registry: France, Germany, Italy, Spain, UK, and USA. USA a little bit higher than Japan for that matter. But that is something on an average what we expect. What is also important is to understand that after an episode of pulmonary embolism, in 6 months, almost 1% of people would have pulmonary arterial hypertension. At 1 year, it increases to 3.1%, and at 2 years, it's about 3.8 to 4% on an average. This is an Indian data where the people, 200 people with chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension were studied. Out of them, 52% had confirmed history of pulmonary embolism, and 20% of them actually turned out to have pulmonary arterial hypertension. It is a dismal prognosis if it is not treated. And this data is from age old 1918 from Rydell et al, that 5 year survival was dismal to 30% if the patients were not treated with chronic thromboembolic pulmonary arterial hypertension, even if they had moderate amount of pulmonary arterial hypertension, that is 40 to 50 millimeters of mercury. And it increased, the survival decreased to 10% if there was severe pulmonary arterial hypertension of more than 50 millimeters of mercury. It was also similar dismal result in 2001 by Lujic. However, if we offer treatment, medical or surgical, the prognosis does dramatically improve. And the 5 year survival improves to 65% if they are properly treated, guided that there are no associated medical conditions. However, if there are associated medical conditions, which I'm going to allude on now, the prognosis is still dismal to less than 15% 5 year survival. So this is the schematic of why does the pulmonary arterial hypertension happen in some people with pulmonary embolism. The schematic says that there is pulmonary embolism, which is likely to be because of hypercoagulability state. And this may result into permanent thrombosis. Why? Because of delayed thrombolysis, maybe high PAI1 or factor 8. Also, there could be concomitant factors or associated comorbidities, which as we can evaluate as recurrent infections, splenectomy, non-O-groups, cancers, and hypothyroidism. So we should always evaluate these things. This obstructed pulmonary circulation could lead to two things. One, it increases shear stress in non-occluded vessels because there is no flow in the occluded vessels. The flow in the non-occluded vessels more, and this leads to hypertrophy or arteriopathy, leads to increased pulmonary vascular resistance. And on the other hand, distal thrombosis of the pulmonary arteries leads to again decreased flow and increased pulmonary vascular resistance. And this is possibly a dual pathology leading to chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. So what do we have as a diagnostic algorithm? The symptoms and signs, unfortunately, are almost identical to the common people we have already discussed of pulmonary arterial hypertension. But we should look for history of prior pulmonary venous thromboembolic episodes, pulmonary embolism, etc. If such a person is there, an echocardiogram suggests pulmonary arterial hypertension. They have diagnostic criteria already laid down in the previous sessions. We have to do ventilation perfusion scanning, and even a 5% defect should lead to a possible suspicion of chronic thromboembolic hypertension, where we have to confirm it by angiography, which could be CT angiography or direct pulmonary angiography or MRA. There are certain things to ponder about, and I call them as dilemmas. The first is, in early chronic thromboembolic episodes, just like any PAH also, symptoms could be just mild or non-specific. That's why most of the times it's delayed diagnosis, almost as much as 14 to 15 months in the best centers. 25% of patients may not have a previous history of pulmonary embolism, and 44% not even the history of venous thrombosis in the legs. Symptoms similar to idiopathic hypertension are there, but if we have edema or hypertensis, hemoptysis, this is more likely that we should suspect thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension and evaluate by ventilation perfusion scans. Syncope is usually less common in thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. Right ventricular failure is usually very late in advanced stage, and by that time, the patients are usually very high risk for any kind of treatment. Chronic thromboembolic pulmonary arterial hypertension is also considered only after 3 months of pulmonary embolism. Till the time, these 3 months should be properly anticoagulated, and still the pulmonary arterial hypertension should be persisting. The diagnosis is the same because it's a pre-capillary hypertension variety. However, in people who have unilateral thromboembolic hypertension, the pulmonary arterial hypertension may not actually be dissected out in cardiac cath as well. So this is the gold standard today, that it has a very high sensitivity and specificity of just even 5%. You can see perfusion defects here in the lung fields in the ventilation perfusion scans, which is the hallmark of suspecting chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. Also, in CTPA, a very common thing is mosaic pattern, where we can have hyperperfusion and low perfusion patterns. Unfortunately, in 12% people without thromboembolic hypertension, also this pattern could be found. There are certain typical types of patterns seen on direct pulmonary angiograms. There could be a ring-like stenosis here. There could be a web-like lesions which can be seen in these pulmonary angiograms. There could be subtotal rat tail appearance. There could be a total occlusion or a tortuous occlusions which can be seen here. All these varieties could be found in various patients with chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. But the important thing is treatment, because this is one of the treatable factors of chronic thromboembolic pulmonary arterial hypertension. The gold standard still is pulmonary endarterectomy. And this is something which is the schematic given, that if we diagnose chronic thromboembolic pulmonary arterial hypertension, a multidisciplinary team should evaluate these patients for technical availability for risk-benefit ratio for pulmonary thromboembolectomy, which is surgical approach on heart-lung machine. Or they could be, if they're not operable, we can think about balloon pulmonary valvuloplasty, or we can think about medical therapies in these particular patients. As far as pulmonary endarterectomy is concerned, nearly 24 to 37% people in CTEPH may not be candidate for pulmonary endarterectomy in best centers because of comorbid situations or high-risk situations or patient denials. Mortality is 4.7%, but it is very good. In our center, we have more than 100 patients' data, which says 1.5% mortality. Risk of pulmonary edema is always there, and we have to watch for that. And some people may require ECMO or a balloon pump support during the recovery or perioperative phase. In the higher experience centers, the mortality is lesser, and 17 to 35% patients have persistent and recurrent pulmonary arterial hypertension even after pulmonary embolectomy. And these patients are because of microangiopathy, and they are best treated with medical management. As far as balloon pulmonary embolectomy is concerned, 50% of patients would land up with pulmonary edema, and we have to watch for. The Japanese are using this technology that they limit the procedure to 1 to 2 pulmonary segments only at one sitting, and they usually do multiple sittings on an average of 4.8 to 5 sessions per patient on average. And this way, they can reduce the mortality to less than 2% in their patients. So this is a schematic of what we do. If the main pulmonary artery is involved, or lobar or segmental, larger pulmonary artery more than 3 centimeters, surgical option is the treatment of choice. If it is smaller, 3 millimeters or 2 millimeters, the segmental or subsegmental balloon pulmonary artectomy is something which is preferred. However, it is microvascular, less than 1 centimeter, 1 millimeter diameter, the treatment of choice would be medical therapy. These are the guidelines given in 2015 and still followed, that class 2A indication in patients who are pulmonary embolism survivor with exercise-induced dyspnea, the tonic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension should be considered. Lifelong anticoagulation is recommended in all the patients with CTEPH. This is class 1C. If we look at the multidisciplinary approach, this is recommended as class 1C. Surgical pulmonary embolectomy is of class 1C. And in class 1B indication, ROC goad. I would like to actually just communicate to you here that ROC goad is one treatment which is proven to be beneficial medical therapy in patients who have distal CTEPH. Residual pulmonary hypertension after endarterectomy, non-operable CTEPH, or bridging therapy to endarterectomy in those patients hemodynamically severe disease. So this is something which is the latest. In the interest of time, I'll end my talk here. Thank you.
Sanjay, that was a very good talk. So which are the patients which you feel should not go for surgery and should be straight away taken up for a balloon?
So as I said, if they have comorbidities and expected mortality of surgery to be more than 10%, they would be not benefited by doing surgery. In my opinion, those have a very high pulmonary arterial pressure. They have to be stabilized first and then taken off for surgery. They have comorbid situations such as cancers or some other diseases which are limiting their lifespan for less than 1 year, they should not be subjected to pulmonary thromboembolectomy.
Questions from the audience?